So Vikash, we also have, every session we will have one of the topics talks about in terms of opportunities and challenges, and this is where I want to call Satya in. Satya is an entrepreneur, he's also been an investor, he has invested in a lot of different things, including alkaline water. So he's also, he works 20 hours a day, and his interests vary from aviation to blockchain. Blockchain is his new baby, where he is part of a very, can I say, a hotshot startup in blockchain from US. So he's got some very marquee guys backing that venture there. So we thought he would be a best guy to come and talk about the kind of opportunities we have. Well, he's also working with Albertsons. He's the CTO for their IoT venture. And so, yeah, in 20 years, looks less for it. But so we'll just get started with Satya's quick talk before we take a break, after which we will get into the pitches.
I'm currently working in Albertsons at a level where we are actually catering banking sector. So I have a small IT team, but Albertsons as such is a 20-year-old company which has about 300 engineers spread across the country in almost all the states. And we are serving almost all the banks, SBI to the smallest Grameen bank. But I actually head the technology department inside Albertsons, where we are doing the customer engagement and digital signage. And one new thing which we have done, which is not existing, is digital challan for Canara Bank. Canara Bank has a thing called as Candy Digital, Canara Digital Candy. And we have given them digital challan, where they can fill in a challan at home and go to the bank. Now coming to blockchain, I'm sure everyone must have heard about blockchain. So I actually don't know how much deep we should go with blockchain, or should I just touch the surface, or should I touch the applications, or should I touch technology, programming platforms in blockchain, even more with Bitcoin touching $20,000 mark. Everyone may not even know about blockchain, including some Palmwallas know about what is blockchain, what is Bitcoin at least. So Bitcoin and blockchain are not the same. Bitcoin is built on blockchain. So there are many other coins, as you are aware, there are many other alternate coins. As of now, there are so many coins, but around 2000 coins have been in the market. 2000 types of coins have been in the market. 2000. Crypto coins. 2000 crypto coins.
That is not considering
many ICOs which are coming up. Do people know what is an ICO? Who don't know about ICO?
We don't know about that.
Okay, very good. Very brief. Like how we do public offering of a company, there is an initial coin offering. When you come up with a concept and when you come up with a crypto coin, you go through what is called as an ICO, and people subscribe for an ICO. And they subscribe for ICO because they are getting it. They are getting a coin which is worth say $2,000 or 2,000 rupees for about 1/4 of it, or even less than it, sometimes 1/10 of it. So people subscribe to ICO, get the coins into their pocket, wallet, wherever, and then when it goes public, the ICO price goes up, and more people start subscribing, and because of the supply demand, stuff like what any of the share market does, the coin price goes up, and people who have subscribed, who have backed the company during the initial phases, during the startup phases, have got the edge and would get the benefit of price going up. That is ICO. What Lalju said was one such ICO.
Who would be adding more and more coins to it?
There would be an algorithm. In Bitcoin,
that person will raise immediately.
No, there will be no person involved in adding more coins to it. There would be a system, process, and an algorithm which would dictate how many coins to be added. And for instance, if you have to substantiate an example for it, suppose I have an ICO. Suppose I have an idea. Suppose I have an idea of a healthcare, startup or whatever, which does monitoring of patients, and which gives out different types of signals, which is a regular idea which you would all know, where IoTs are used for monitoring the patient. If this idea had to be backed up, the company would say, I would require 10,000 rupees to run this company. And if I can monitor 2,000 patients, I would require 20,000. If I have to monitor 4,000, I would require 50,000. And so on and so forth. They would have some math behind how much of money is required to do how much of work. Money, proof of work. So,
is it IPO digital IPO?
Yes, it is a digital IPO. It is exactly digital IPO. It also
shares.
Yes, it is like shares, but instead of having a share, you will have a coin. Share can be a paper share or a dematerialized number which is in your account, like you own 10 Tata shares. So it could be a certificate, share certificate which says 10 shares to Mr. X, or it could be dematerialized and given into your demat account as 10 TAT share, Tata shares. So ICO is also the same. We'll give you coins. The coin prices can go up and down. One such coin is our Bitcoin. There are many other coins. Bitlight, there are a huge number of coins. As I said, there are about 2,000 good coins. There are about 10-20 very good coins which are doing very, very good. How many of you have heard of Ripple? Good. So you know. You know how Ripple has taken over the market from $1 to whatever is the current Ripple price, probably 1,000 times more than what it was at ICO. 1,000 times more. That means had you put $1, you would have got $1,000 as of now. Whether there are many other good coins as well. The concept of Ripple? Ripple is a concept where you can transfer money from one place to other geographies, from one company to other, in an instant. You don't have to use banking. These crypto coins are heavily prone for hacking because there is no regulatory body. There is no jurisdiction around it. When I meant jurisdiction, what I meant was, like, if I rob your wallet, your physical purse, your wallet, there is a jurisdiction as to it comes under certain thing, and I have. If I do some cybercrime to you, it is a different jurisdiction, which there is a cybercrime law, which says, if I have done an online fraud, these are the things. This is the way how I have to be punished. So in Bitcoin, there is no such thing as to what would be the jurisdiction around it and who is the jurisdiction, who has to enforce this. Like, for instance, if your pocket was picked in Bangalore, it is under this jurisdiction, they'll say, sir, this police station, this is not our police station. So then there is a jurisdiction which says, I will enforce law in this locality and you have to come here and make a complaint, and I will ensure that you will be given justice, or the person will be taken to court. In this, there is still not that yet. There are some organizations, groups, which are working towards it. many organizations, many groups are working towards it. They are all looking at laying down some certain rules and certain what you say process as to how to prove that you are lean. Does it answer your question, sir? To an extent. Some of the concepts itself are vague. Some of the concepts itself are vague in terms of jurisdiction.
We can understand. Maybe round the corner will catch you by cyber laws or something.
Yes, to an extent. Now also to prove, because there is a lot of anonymity involving Bitcoins. Because you also want to be very anonymous. You don't want to. That is the beauty of Bitcoins. You can hold, say, 20 crores in Bitcoins, and people would not know who owned it. It would be a big number, which is your private key, which is your wallet key.
Recently, there have been text people have been catching. There are a lot of news. People who have made money out of Bitcoin now, they have to pay people text from
Bitcoin. Yes, sir, there are many such.
Some of them have been able to catch it.
Yes, sir. It is. But the source to that anonymous account can be traced. The source to the anonymous account can be traced. There, again, a vague answer to it is, there is traceability if required, and there is no traceability if you want to be. If you don't want to be traceable, then you go to some offshore tax haven like go to Mauritius, declare yourself as some A Patel, B Patel, C Patel, D Patel, have four accounts, different accounts.
Maybe Cayman Islands, Mauritius not allowed
anymore. Yeah, not anymore. Now they have this Cayman Islands, Bermuda, anywhere else. So the anonymous part of it is left to you, sir. As to you want to do a legitimate business or you want to do under the hood. But Bitcoin lets itself to
you. You could mention who are the biggest users of it that you
take. Well, the users of Bitcoin itself could be starting from, I have seen many small students who own half a Bitcoin or one Bitcoin who are using it for experimenting. To businessmen, like I think Amitabh Bachchan himself has declared that the recent news that he has so many Bitcoins worth so many crores. So that is the spread. There are students who are using it to do good stuff. There are even students who are using it to buy drugs and buy weapons. And there are good people who are also investing in real estate. There are some real estate companies in the US who accept Bitcoins as the mode of
payment. There are people in Bangalore also who use it. For a coffee for today, you can buy 2-3 days meal.
So, this is the spread. You can even buy a villa with Bitcoin, or you can even buy coffee. There are startups which are doing ATM machines to put in and take in Bitcoins. There are startups who are doing payment machines, like POS, small POS machines, to accept Bitcoins. Could be through a wallet or through a card, and those POSs must be any POS place. You can buy groceries or you can get into a hotel, buy coffee. So these are the. This is the breadth of use cases where Bitcoins are being used. And today's presentation mainly is to tell you what is the breadth in which Bitcoins can be used. Blockchain can be used. Bitcoins can be used for anything. Can be used to buy coffee, to buy an apartment nowadays is a mode of payment. But blockchain is a technology. Blockchain has nothing to do with cryptocurrency. Blockchain is just a technology. And this technology can be used in different verticals. You can use blockchain in different verticals, and I am just about to explain you as to what are these verticals and how it can be used and why it has to be used there, and of course if there are any entrepreneurs as to how we can see an opportunity here in blockchain as a technology platform. So this is just a techno gyan, which is not of very prime importance, but these are the three types of systems which are available as of today. As of today, you have centralized system like a bank, which is a centralized system which has a central place to store all the data, and it disseminates data to other people. Like bank, as a bank server, as a central place, knows your bank balance, your transaction, and email is a centralized server. Then you have decentralized servers, decentralized applications, where the cloud is one such example, where you have multiple places, the data is residing in multiple places, only for the fact that it is huge, for redundancy, that if one node goes down, every single server is a node, so if one node goes down, the other node can serve it, so redundancy is one thing. So that is what is decentralized approach network. Then comes this new concept called as distributed ledgers. In distributed ledgers, there are two things. Anonymous one is one, and non-anonymous one, which is not anonymous one, is the two broad bifurcations of distributed ledgers. But what is distributed ledger on its own? Blockchain or distributed ledger, though they are not, the terms cannot be interoperable at certain level. The distributed ledger is a place where data is stored with everyone. Everyone has access to everything. So you can see these red dots, they have all the data. So everyone has access to everything. So if you manipulate any data, the others would not agree for it. So the suppose you number those, in case you number those red dots as 1, 2, 3, one has all the data, two has all the data. What data are you talking about? The amount of money I have, for instance, or the transactions I made, the purchases I made, and the balance I have. So dot one, red dot one, would have everything in it. So if I go and try to manipulate my values, suppose I have just 10 rupees and I want to manipulate it to make, put one more zero and make it 100 rupees, the other dots would not agree. It would say, no, I don't agree. My ledger says that you have 10 rupees. You have nowhere on the earth you have 100 rupees. So they would not come to an agreement that you have 100 rupees. They all say that you only have 10 rupees in my example. So this is the prime and only benefit this distributed ledgers would give, that the data cannot be manipulated and the data is as secure as it can be. Then why two types of distributed ledgers? Why do you need an anonymous one? Why do you need not an anonymous one? Anonymous one is for everyone and everything, like Bitcoin. And non-anonymous one are for particular applications. If Swiss Bank wants to introduce blockchain into their operations to improve their efficiency, improve their transparency in transactions or whatever, they have to do the non-anonymous way, because it is only for Swiss Bank customers and would-be customers, potential customers. So if you need your part of your data not to be visible to anyone, just because it is very important, and part of which can be only read but not written, then this blue side thing, the non-anonymous one, makes more sense. Dealing with blockchain based applications in whatever domain would implement the non-anonymous ones, and those who want to develop something like a coin or a currency just to exchange value, then they could go for the anonymous ones, which is easier and quicker to develop. As you know, the previous slide says there is what is public, the red one, and what the red one is a public chain, which is a coin on its own. These are the examples: Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Litecoin are some of the examples. As I told you, there are 2,000 more of them. And federated blockchains. Federated blockchains are blockchains which are for a given application. R3, example for R3, is a federated application, which is a consortium of all the banks who have come, and they are developing an operating system on their own. All the big banks, the banks from Singapore, the Swiss banks, Royal Bank of Scotland, UBS, all these banks are coming up with a platform and have already come up with a platform. The platform is R3. And it is a federated one, it is a closed blockchain application, and you don't have access to it. B3I is for insurance implementation. So B3I is again a group, is a blockchain federated closed group blockchain implementation for all insurance companies. Suppose you are an insurance company, suppose you are a small time crop insurance company, and you want to use this technology for crop insurance across, say, 4,000 villages, and you can use B3I to develop on. Then EWF is for energy. Energy web framework. EWF stands for energy web framework. And it is for all the energy companies who want to trade energy. It is for the companies who are producing energy. It is for companies who are distributing energy. It is for companies who are giving carbon credits and whatever. So these are the, this is a framework. It is just a consortium. They have laid out some framework. They have built a platform using blockchain to connect producer, consumer, and distributor. Producers who are producing power, it could be individuals like who have solar panels on their farms and houses who are producing excess power. Then consumer could be me who want to consume power, and distributor could be public system, because public system has the distribution network. So you give it back to the public system, and public system will again distribute back to the consumer. And all the math and other things which are revolving around those ecosystems is EWF. And any private blockchains which you want to develop within your organization or corporation is the private blockchains. I'll actually run through this very quickly, because most of you are aware of all this, and of course interest of time.